Good afternoon. Thank you for being here. Your presence is a blessing to family and to this church and to the others who are sitting beside you and around you. Thank you for coming. I'd like to open with prayer, so let's take a moment and pray together. Lord of life, we've come together today not to mourn a death, but to celebrate a life, a remarkable, amazing, wonderful life, the life of our dear friend Louise. Our prayer today is that we may no longer think of her as limited in any way, either by time or space, nor form. Our prayer is that we may see her as you have always seen her, whole and free, and moving on into her next adventure of life. We recognize that of all the changes that occur here on this earth, the most amazing change is this one that we call death. But we pray that we may see it today as a part of life, that life and life alone is the only reality. And Louise is moving now, journeying on into another adventure of life. And we've come together to honor her and to bless her on her journey. For your presence with us today and for your presence with her, we do give thanks. Amen. Whenever someone that we know and love passes, there are questions that come to mind, and these questions are never solved or answered easily. Something in every one of us tells us that we're meant to live, not to die. And yet when someone seemingly, and I say seemingly, fails to do this, the question comes up, why, how, where? Many questions. But in order to find the answers to the dilemma of this experience we call death, we must look to life. For life is the only reality. And death is one of the facts of life, one of the ways in which life expresses itself. And looking at life, we see that all things change and become something else and something more. If Louise were here today, she might explain it to you this way. Picture yourself standing by the seashore, and you're looking out at the blue ocean, and there before you is a beautiful white sailing ship. The sails are unfurled, and she is an object of beauty and strength. And you stand and watch this ship as it begins to sail towards the blue ocean. And pretty soon, all you see is a speck of white where that ship meets the horizon. And someone who's watching with you says, "There, she's gone." Gone where? Gone from your sight, that is all. That ship is just as large in mast and hull and spar as it was when it left your side, and it's just as able to bear its load of living weight to its destined harbor. Its diminished size is in you and me, not in her. And at the very moment when someone at your side is saying, "There she's gone," other eyes are watching her approach. And other voices are beginning to shout, "Hey, here she comes." And that is dying. It's a real honor for me to be present here today. I came to this church in 1975, and Louise was a vital and important part of this community. She was involved in the women's program. She was also very outspoken, as you know. And not a Sunday would go by after one of my messages that she would not come up to me and have some opinion that she would share with me. She was very supportive, but she also had other points of view and things that she felt could have or would have added to what I was saying. And I always appreciated. She had great insights. She'd read a lot. She had a marvelous mind and a warm spirit. So I always took her gems of wisdom with love. Another beneficial service that she performed for me and my wife, we were married in this church in 1978, and Louise was present at that wedding. And afterwards, she said, "I have a wedding present for you. Come around to my house and I will do your astrological charts for you," which she did. And we still have them. In fact, last time I visited Louise, I mentioned that to her, and she said, "You still have them?" And I said, "Yes, we do." And I would think that the stars and planets are in alignment today. She would agree for this occasion and for us coming together. But there are those who knew her much more deeply than I did, and that would be her family, and perhaps some of you who might want to share. But I'm going to call upon son Mike to come up first and share his insights. Mike?
Hello, everyone. My tribute to Mom is in the form of a letter to Mom, a thank you note. This past month or so, looking through a lot of photographs, I found a drawer of thank you notes to me from her, that she would send me a thank you note whenever I did anything for her. And so this is a tribute and a thank you note to Mom. So, farewell to you, my beautiful mother. It's hard to believe that you're really gone. It doesn't seem possible. You've been such a huge part of so many lives. Thank you for a lifetime of love and unwavering support. Thank you for so many wonderful memories. You lived your life for love. You loved many people, and you were loved by many people. Thank you for the happy childhood you gave me. I always knew that I was loved and wanted, and that is something that cannot be taken for granted. As the youngest, you were a little more lenient with me. I saw a slightly gentler mom than my older brothers did. But as proud as you were of your children, we were the lucky ones. Though you had limited resources, our childhoods were full of trips to Disneyland and the beach. And even though the latest Disney movie was playing down the street, you always made time to take us to see it at the big theater in Hollywood. Mary Poppins, The Jungle Book, and, in my opinion, the worst movie ever made, The Sound of Music. thank you also for the advice I never took, to eat my food slowly and only eat when I was hungry. Those were words of wisdom that fell on deaf ears. You were always open to a new experience. You loved a great concert. The Doobie Brothers, Stevie Wonder, Neil Diamond, you were up for all of them. I'm glad I was able to be there for you this last decade. I know it wasn't easy for you. You had been ready to pass for quite some time. The opportunity to spend time with you and show you my love has meant so much to me. the trips to Manitou Park or Baskin-Robbins or lunch at the Skyway Cafe will always be precious memories. You had many friends and were light in the lives of many. You loved giving dinner parties in your home. You were a fantastic cook at everything but fish. You made such a difference in so many lives. You were the friend and mother that everyone wants. Thank you for a lifetime of beautiful memories. One of the best is the day in 1998 when you showed me where you had grown up in Los Angeles. Your family lived behind their dry cleaning store, and that is how they weathered the Great Depression. We saw the places of your early life, your grade school, high school, and others. It was an unbelievably clear day for LA. We saw the sights, had lunch at the world-famous House of Pie, and then drove to the Griffith Observatory and took in the unbelievable view all the way to Catalina Island. That memory I will always treasure. I was asked last week what your greatest qualities were. I had never thought about it. I think your open heart and generosity were the greatest things about you. You effortlessly loved and cared for so many people. I want to say again, you loved many people and are loved by many people. I'll miss your blunt, matter-of-fact comments. I'll miss the smile I saw at the simplest kindness I would extend. I'll miss the joy it gave me when I came to visit. Since you've passed, I somehow expected you to materialize in front of me like in a movie. I guess it doesn't work that way. I know that you're now in heaven, and I'm relieved that you are out of pain. I will miss the loving mother, the kind soul, and the generous spirit that you possessed. You will live on in my heart. Thank you for being my mother. How lucky I am. I know that someday I'll see you again, but for now, I will send my love and gratitude and just say farewell for now, my beautiful mother.
Thank you, John. You done good. Yeah. John, or that's Mike. This is John. And John's going to come up and share now.
And I'll play a song when
I'm
through there. Okay, great. Lights on. Okay, I should have had it on before. Yep, notes. I got notes. Okay, well, hello, and thank you for coming today. It's great to see so many faces that I remember from the past. My name's John Charleston, and I'm Louise, her eldest son. I guess you could say that Mom and I almost grew up together since I joined her life when she was just 19 years old. We did a lot of growing up together, different generations on a similar path, and it was an interesting journey. I want to share some of that journey with you. It was a very interesting experience being raised by a single mom in the 1950s. Mom was a waitress and worked nights. I was raised by her paternal grandmother, and I remember that she would attend some school events, parent-teacher events, and I recall how difficult the stigma of being a single parent was for her. I call my mother a seeker. She was always, well, almost always seeking the truth. And she explored many avenues in life to satisfy her curiosity and reinforce her beliefs. I can remember as a child going to many spiritual events, meeting some of the most fascinating people, and learning things that certainly expanded my growing perspective of life. There was the Edgar Cayce retreats in Palm Springs, the symposiums on Atlantis and Lemuria at Asilomar in Pacific Beach, light and aromatherapy classes in the Southland, and of course her love for astrology. Over the years I learned from her friends how proud she was of having me as her son. Even men she considered in relationships showed up courting her with gifts for me. One nice man named Roy was a sailor, and he brought me a complete authentic sailor suit he had made for me in Japan and took me to Long Beach to give me a personal tour of the ship he sailed on. Yes, Mom was hard to impress. Being a Scorpio, right. Mom trusted my inner gifts and would pull me out of school to go with her to Santa Anita Racetrack so I could view the horses and pick the ones I thought would win, and we won often. We would sometimes go downtown to Tay's French restaurant where Mom had worked for years. The people there were so friendly, and sometimes her friend Claude would take me down into the old basement, the kind that had the round glass bottles and the concrete above and the sidewalk to let in the natural light. And then I could see all the rows of wine and the olives and the cheese and the smells. It was just fascinating. I have such great memories growing up as Mom's friend. Thank you, Mom. Carrying over from her family's religious beliefs, we studied Ernest Holmes' works and attended the Church of Religious Science, eventually landing at the Unity Church in Covina. In that regard, she also lived in spiritual confusion and uncertainty, causing me to attend Catholic school for a year until I ran away. Those were magical years. I really could write a book about all the different things that happened during those times. It was just amazing. So that was my life with Mom until I was 13. And at 13, I did something very bad. I stole a really nice bicycle. I remember it was a brand new Schwinn 15-speed. I don't know what the hell I was thinking. Where was I going to hide this, you know? I mean, that night, Mom came home, and it was like all over. You know, I really started the war. And so she sent me to live with her father, my grandfather. His name's Frank Ames, and Mike mentioned him earlier. Frank was a tough man. During the Great Depression, he worked as a scab non-union truck driver. He drove through many picket lines. He was involved in numerous life-threatening fights. And he was pissed that I had done such a bad deed. But he was even angrier at Mom for allowing me to grow up that way. So off I went to live with my grandfather, who at that time owned the largest dry cleaning plant in Los Angeles. The plant was in Watts. My mom was born only a few miles away in Huntington Park, and I was born around the corner in the city of Bell. Life was tough living with Frank, and my mom was distraught that she had left me in such a predicament. However, we both came from a basic belief that everything in life is the way it's supposed to be, perfect. And we had to look for the good, look for the meaning in all things. And yes, we are meaning-making machines, aren't we? I can't begin to tell you all the life experiences I had living with Frank Ames. Overall, they were good. I am the man I am today because of him. But my spiritual side is from my mother. I stayed with Frank and his family for nearly 3 years. In that time, I learned what slave labor was all about. I experienced the kind of hard work that my mom and her brother Russell experienced working in a toxic, chemically saturated environment, which eventually caused much of the health problems for both Mom and her brother. And I got to experience racism firsthand, being one of the very few white people that worked at the plant. In fact, I was one of the few white people that was in the neighborhood. And I even got to experience the energy of racial hatred during the Watts riots, which will never leave my soul. Eventually, it was time for me to leave Frank Ames and continue my life experiences. And due to new relationships in Mom's life and her openness to allow me to fully experience my life, she allowed me to live on my own at 15 years old. I did have a legal guardian with me. That was the bass player in the band. And so our lives started separate paths. In 1968, Mom married John Walls, and we had a double wedding as I married my son's mother at the same ceremony. No shotguns. In 1970, we both went in different directions. I, along with my wife and new son, took off with a rock and roll band and started a new chapter in my life. And Mom and her husband, John Walls, felt strongly that California was evil and doomed and was destined to slide off the continental shelf into the ocean very shortly. John researched and discovered Deep Lake, Washington, about 12 miles east of Northport, near the Canadian border. They bought an old small house, and there's a picture of it out there on the boards. We really tried to include a lot of her life on those boards. Pretty neat. The heating and cooking were by wood. There were neighbors down the road a ways. And while the house did have electricity and a phone, there was no TV or broadcast signals available back then. So I had the honor of taking Mom back through memory lane just a few years ago to visit those special places she loves so much. Brother Mike related to me how John and he loaded the big U-Haul truck in West Covina, California, drove up to Deep Lake, unloaded the truck, and John left 8-year-old Mike there to watch the stuff while he drove down to California, loaded up again, and drove back to Deep Lake. I mean, you would be in prison for that today, right? It's amazing. Recognize that we came from the land of Disneyland, and I can only imagine what 8-year-old Mike felt like watching that U-Haul driving away around the bend to be left with only the sound of the breeze and wild critters. After a season of difficult existence, Mom, John Walls, and the two boys moved into Northport, where Mom experienced some of the most meaningful years of her life. She so loved life there. While there, the next eldest son, Raymond, found living in the remote unbearable and was not having a good life. At 13, he came to live with me and my family, who had settled down on a 50-acre farm in Ritzdown, Ohio. Now, by 23, I had taken another turn in my life, and I had become an avid Jehovah's Witness. So quiet it is. For 15 years, I got out, okay. Anyway, similar to the emotional energy I was thrust into living with my grandfather, Brother Raymond was forced to come and live with his older brother, John, in a strict Bible-based community, and after a year and a half, he was eager to leave and go back to Spokane. The family decided the boys needed more interaction than was available in Northport, so they moved to Spokane, to the house on 14th. Mom continued her spiritual journey after moving to Spokane and attended Unity Church right here in this building, through which she met so many wonderful friends. Phew. And it is good to see you here today. In her late 40s, she became interested in Tibetan Buddhism, which changed her astrological influence. She became a prominent person in the Unity community and loved this church. In her early 60s, her hip failed and she fell. Her health continued to decline, and I moved to Spokane in 1995 to see how she was doing. As you know, Spokane is not on the way to anywhere else, so I had only been up here twice since 1975. It was here in Spokane that Mom introduced me to Cecily, my wife, and that introduction came with a very stern warning from Mom, quote, "You be nice to her, she's a nice lady." That was nearly 18 years ago, and thank you, Mom. In her late 60s, she concluded that she could not care for her South Hills home on 14th any longer, sold it, and determined to move to Hawaii to live in the Buddhist community with Lama Karma Rinchen. And although she thought that was to be her next big life experience, something did not work out, and in 3 months she decided to come back home to Spokane. Later in her inner spiritual battle, it continued. The uncertainty between her beliefs and wanting to have a complete Christian experience moved her to join a Baptist church, accept Christ, and be baptized under water. Her final years were rough. Her health was failing, and as a strong believer in karma, Mom certainly paid off huge karmic debt. I felt so bad for her, yet in the background was the obvious that everything must be perfect. There was nothing more that could be done, as dementia had become the norm. And so to help her keep her sanity, I put together a digital picture frame that showed images from happy times throughout her life. And I believe this helped her. She could remember most of the people in the images through her last year. As her past year unfolded, she was so blessed with special people that came into her life. I can only hope that as my life comes to an end, there will be the love and support she had. And like all those that came into her life, each took away both life's lessons and honest love from this woman. I thank God. I thank God for all the angels he brought to her during this life. And I will miss him.
Everyone in this room has a unique memory and impression that is indelibly left on your soul as a result of having crossed paths with Louise, encountered her in your life. My dad had an expression that he always used, and it was, "It takes one to know one." And I've always believed that anything that you like or dislike in another person, some aspect of that is present in your own being and in your own soul. and especially that which you admired and appreciated about Louise. Any quality that stood out for you, anything you learned from her, any insight that she gave you about life, that exists in you. Sometimes when we gather for occasions like this, you will hear the expression, we gather together to pay our last respects to the one who has passed on. And I've never, ever believed that to be true. I think our respect for Louise begins today. When I had the opportunity to speak on Sunday mornings here at the church, after the service was over, I'd stand at the door and greet people, and people respectfully had listened for most of my sermons. Sometimes they finished before I did, but they would respectfully, shake my hand or give me a hug, or including Louise, tell me a few things about what I just said. And that's respectful. But the real respect started the moment they walked out the door and got into their automobile and went back into their life. For then they had the opportunity to apply something that they had learned that day and incorporate it into their own life and family and community. And for me, that's the true respect. And so anything that you admired about her, anything that stands out, anything that drew you to her, as I said, it exists in you, and you have the opportunity to keep it going, to let it shine through your life, so that what we have is not a stone that marks her place, but lives like yours continuing to pass the torch and live the life and be Louise at her very best. That's true respect. One more thing, and that is that there is always the feeling that no matter how long someone has been ill, that once they have passed, we feel, oh, there was something I was going to share with her. There was something left unsaid. There was something that I really wanted to be sure she knew. And now it's too late. But that's not true. It's never too late to communicate with those that we love, and we will continue to communicate with her. All you have to do is think of her, and you are with her, and she is with you. And she's out of reach of our hands now, but she's not out of reach of our heart and our soul and our spirit. And so at any time, of any place, any day, we have the opportunity to just think of Louise and be with her. And if there's something left unshared, something that you need to say, some need for forgiveness, something you didn't say that you wanted to say, take that opportunity to communicate. You might even get a reply. From knowing Louise, you probably will. So in that consciousness, we'll conclude this service. In a moment, we're going to have a closing prayer, and we're going to sing the peace song. Some of you may not know that. Are we going to do that? I beg your pardon?
Is there anybody that wanted to share?
Oh, did you want some folks to share? I'm sorry. I'm in a hurry. No, I'm not. Those of you who want to share, please come forward. Yeah.
Mike. Film Doc. My name is Steve Bush. I was a neighbor. Louise was in our life, my family's life, my children's life, for 27 years. you married us right here. I look different. You know, it's real easy to get caught up in what we did in response to what she did. But, you know, one of the things I found is that John, you mentioned the fact that she broke her leg, her hip. It was at my house. She went down a flight of stairs. You also mentioned the fact that, you know, everything's perfect. And I'd like to just share that at the time she came down the stairs and broke her hip, I was in my second year at Multnomah Bible College. I was there because God had called me to a ministry, and it was Louise. Louise encouraged me. Of all the people in my life, Louise packed up her bags and went to Vancouver. And we camped out because we needed to look for a place to live. That was Louise. When I met Louise, she came out and said on our first day, "Your children are too loud and I can't do my consulting." That was the intro. I thought, as I said to my wife, "Honey, I think we have a problem." It only took her a week to fall in love with my children. Took her about that long to adopt us as a family. It was a little embarrassing as an evangelical Christian to have a practicing Buddhist astrologist introduce everybody as, "Well, this is my spiritual family." That was our start. And it got better from there. I mean, you know, we lived next door.
Serena.
Okay, I knew that there was a name change and stuff. And I had one of your checks someplace, you know, where it was crossed out and I'm an angel. But anyway, the thing is, we lived next to Josh and his mom, Serena. And so it was kind of an interesting thing. But you said that everything worked out perfectly, and we had moved back, and we didn't have any place to be. We moved in next to your mom. And she just gives. Even when it doesn't seem like it's the right thing, she's one of those people that just pulls out of whatever's going on, and it's the right thing. Moving back to Spokane, I was depressed. I had 3 kids. I had a job. You know, yada, 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 yada. Everybody's been in some place where you're going, She's the lady that showed up at my doorstep. Your mom made the best. Bar none, the best. You ready for this? She made the best of any that I've ever had, cinnamon rolls.
Oh, yeah.
You guys ever have any of those? You don't look like you enjoyed them as much as I did, all right? But here's the thing. She showed up at my door, and she said, "Hi, honey." She was always calling me darling or honey, and it was a little embarrassing, you know, but I got over it because I found out she meant it. She had this big bowl. She had a cover on it. And she says, "Guess what we're doing today?" I says, "I have no clue." And I'm in my sweats, and I look like, well, I look really terrible. And she pushed her way into the door. Upstairs we went. We made cinnamon rolls that day. And she was good at that, wasn't she? She was good at including you. She was good at saying, "Well, we can do this." She just had that. And so we went to Vancouver. We found a place. We moved in. She came down to spend time. Thought it was a great idea. But second story down, and this is where I found out that I'm not as cool, calm, and collected as I thought I was, because when your mom hit the basement or the wall and she's laying there and she's in a lot of pain, my wife says, "Go call the ambulance." Do you know how to call the ambulance in almost any city in America? 911, right? I'm looking in the phone book for ambulance. The point I want to make is that it was perfect. It didn't seem perfect that night. She went to the hospital. But in the process, she spent, I think it was about a month, in my wife and I's bedroom. We turned it into a place for her. And in that period of time, she didn't become Baptist. I didn't become Baptist. I was evangelical. But the thing is that we read the Bible together. We talked. And you know, my heart was to share a relationship that I hadn't grown up with. I was 30 years old before. I mean, I went to Unity. I went to a lot of different places. I was hungry for everything. I think that she and I were kindred spirits. We looked. But the thing was is that we shared and we talked. And your mom was nothing if not honest. And if she said something, she meant it. And about 6 months later, she calls me up and says, guess what, honey? I'm going, I don't know, what, hip, you know, because I got a little nervous, you know. It's not every day somebody breaks a hip. But she says, you know, I'm pretty confident that Jesus is who he is and who he says he is. He says, he's mine. And she just basically said that. I said, yeah, and I'm pretty excited. And I'm the one that got to stand in the water and baptize her. It was one of the best days of my life. Because it was just, she's family. And when she introduced us as her spiritual kids, we felt it. And it was real. And so for me, I know where she's at. I know what she's doing. And I know that I'm going to see her again. And I just, you know, I had to be here. It was, you know, I'm out of Yakima or Yakima, depending on which part of the country you're from, right? Yeah, we're going to Yakima or Spokane, right? But the thing is that the Louise has for 27 years been a part of almost my daily, if not weekly, life. There isn't hardly a time that I talk to somebody about what God's done in my life that Louise isn't a part of it. That what she did in reaching out to us as a family, when she drugged me to Toastmasters, I never talked in front of anybody. She said, oh, come on, darling, we're going to go. I don't want to go. I'll take you. No, I don't want to go. But she put her life in a way that I've never had anybody do that before. Was she perfect? Nah, she wasn't. She brought me oxtail soup once. I'm telling you what, that was not, you know, that's not what I was looking for, all right? But I just wanted the opportunity to share with you that what she had been searching for, she said, man, I found it. And regardless of where you're at, you know, in your spiritual walk, where you are, what I know is that we shared something. And even up to the very end, even when your mom was confused at different times, I'd call up and drive my wife crazy because she would remember who I was. My wife would say, hi, Louise. And Louise would go, hello. And then I'd get on the phone, Louise, oh, darling. I still hear that voice. Your mom, proud of you. You know, proud of her boys. And there's just something about her. And I was blessed. And I was blessed to be a part of just that journey. I could not believe it. I mean, a month with her. Can you imagine being a month with her where she can't go someplace she wants to go? I mean, she was not ambulatory, so she was captive.
You need a duct tape.
She'd ring the bell, I'm here. And you know, the funny part of it was the school I was in, they gave me credit for a ministry for that month. We were expected to have ministry. I said, well, I got this. And she said, and they said, okay. Best month of my life. Great mom, great friend.
Thank you.
As a representative of Louise's Buddhist life, it's only right that I go next. I like to refer to myself as a Jewish Christian Buddhist because I've been all three. I want to bring this today. This is Louise's life mask. At first I had it in my kitchen because I'm a lousy cook and I thought that maybe her influence would, you know, but it didn't. That's okay. And then I had it in my office. And so I decided I would bring it today because I'm ready to pass it on to anyone who would like to have Louise looking over them. So that's Louise's life mask, which I have loved having. I met Louise in 1992. I was, my name, by the way, is Sarah Edlin Marlowe, for those who don't know me. I was doing outdoor drama in Chillicothe, Ohio, and I'd gotten a job at Gonzaga, and we'd come to town and found a house. But I didn't have any place to live from the time I got here to when we closed on the house and I started school. and all of that. And I've been a practicing Buddhist since 1978. And I had this wonderful book called The 12 Women in America, 12 Buddhist Women in America. And Lama Inga Sandvoss, who runs the Dharma Center on 7th here on South Hill, was in it. And so I called her and I said, "Hi, you know, do you have any rooms to rent in your Dharma house? I'm coming to town and it'll be a week before I can move into my house." And she said, "No, but I have a friend who rents out rooms." So she got me in touch. Louise sent me a letter and I stayed with her, and that was August of 1992. Stayed with her for a week. And we've been good friends ever since. And I also studied astronomy under her. I'm not very good. I'm not as good as she is. But I did study with her because she said I had a talent for it. I don't know if that's really true, but I dabble in it from time to time. But she was really, you know, she was brusque. She was honest. She was blunt. She is a Scorpio. November 11th, I thought. It said November 29th. Yeah, November 11th. Yes, November 11th. Because I'm a Scorpio too, and my mother was a Scorpio. And Louise really reminded me of my mother, and I always felt that in some way I had let my mother down because my mother was in Hawaii and I was here, and so she died with friends of mine, but not with me there. And so I kind of took on Louise as my surrogate mother, even though she's only 14 years older than me. And it turned out that we had both taken refuge with the same Lama, Lama Rinchen, in Honolulu, and his picture is out there. And I was kind of sad for her when her 3-month Hawaii trip did not work out, because Hawaii is my heart home. I lived there for 10 years. And I was hoping that would work out for her, but it didn't. But what I wanted to share today, and this is something we do as Buddhists, is we, and I'm not quite sure why it's 49 days, but there's a prayer that we do for 49 days, sending the deceased person's soul to wherever it is they're going next. And so I've been doing this, and I will continue to do this for 49 days from the day that she died. And I did see her the day before she died. She wasn't awake, but I walked into her room and I looked at her and I thought, she looks really clear. And that felt good to me because I know she was really ready to go, to leave behind the suffering. So this is actually a red Tara practice. There are several Taras. I don't know if you know anything about Hinduism or Buddhism, but a lot of the gods and goddesses are sort of emanations of various aspects of our own wisdom, if you will, the cosmology of the world. So this is called From Tara's Heart. Tara is a feminine emanation of Buddha. From Tara's heart, a rainbow light shines forth throughout the six realms and the bardo, enveloping the deceased ones wherever they are, purifying their karma, and infusing them with Tara's radiant blessing. Their forms become brilliant spheres of light and dissolve into Tara's heart mind, a realm beyond the cycles of suffering, a realm of absolute purity and bliss. And so I have her picture on my altar, and every day I say this prayer and I envision her becoming part of Tara's heart mind, a realm beyond cycles of suffering, where she's at peace.
Hi there, I'm Josh Michael. I met Louise when I was 7 years old. I have nothing prepared, just lots of thoughts. So when I was 7, me and my mom, she's a single mother, and so Louise became, probably to a lot, quite a few children, but she became my spiritual grandmother. I had a much closer connection, much deeper connection with Louise than any of my other grandparents. I've actually never been there. I'm not crying, but I've never felt so overwhelmed in a funeral or a memorial service than today. This is really hard. But Louise, she was from the age of 7 on, just there. She was my rock. My mom had to work, and so I would come home every day, and I'd check in with Louise next door, 15 feet, 20 feet from my front door. Come home right from Roosevelt and just spend a lot of time making lots and lots of cinnamon rolls, cookies. That's where I started, you know, all of my baking skills. My mom did, but I spent many, many hours baking in her kitchen. My fondest memories in my life are in that house. I got to spend so much time with so many amazing people. She had the most amazing friends. Loved throwing parties, and oh God, the day that she decided to not keep her house, I mean, I just couldn't believe it because she was the entertainer. She loved people, and so it was so, I just couldn't believe that she would, I didn't think her soul could support not entertaining, but she did manage, she was so much, she was, yeah. So thank you all for coming.
I'm Serena Lauren, and that was my son Josh, and we did move in there when he, actually I think it was before seven, I think it was at the end of kindergarten. But anyway, Louise was a spiritual mom to me, and really filled so many holes that weren't there in my family of origin. And she, again, very much like what Steve said, you know, she immediately claimed us as family. And I remember in 1992, our church here was going, they had a trip to Russia. And, you know, I could never even imagine going out of the country. I mean, it wasn't in my scheme of possibility. And one day I was talking with her and she just said, you know, you're going to Russia and I'm going to take care of Josh. And I went, no, how could I do that? You know, I couldn't even imagine. But I went to Russia and she watched Josh for more than 2 weeks, I think. And that was a comforting place for him. I mean, even though I think it was also a stretch for that tender age that he was. But that was Louise. We had keys to each other's houses. I'd come home and there'd be cinnamon rolls in the house. I'd walk in the door and it would just smell amazing. And I'm like, I know who's been here. Or there'd be a note, I borrowed 2 eggs, or I borrowed a cup of sugar, or do you have blah, blah, blah. And so that was just our life. And, you know, she was just the most precious, precious being, and such a light in my life for the 7 years that we lived next door and the years after that, too. You know, I just... And I know that she's doing well. And in fact, a few minutes ago, when my eyes were closed during Amazing Grace, I saw her twirling. And then after the song was over, I thought, oh, that reminds me of that whirling dervish picture she used to have in her living room. The dancer in the sand. And I thought, I just had this vision of her twirling and almost in a cape. So I think she's having a good time. And I think she's really happy that we're remembering her today. Thank you.
Normally I would apologize for my phone going off. However,
it was off.
It was Louise. And of course Louise is pissed. Not of course, but she just wanted to be here and hear what everybody had to say about her, because she knew there were many, many good things that were going to be said. I met her when I first moved into Canterbury Court, and that was in year 2000, and of course through her I met John and Mike, who were there a lot, and I remember going out to John's house up on Green Bluff and getting to know Mike, because he worked very close to that. And I didn't have a car when I first moved in. So Louise offered to let me take her to the store. So I was at least able to drive a little bit. But she wasn't sure because she thought that old Buick was a Rolls Royce. She would tell me, you know, turn here, be careful, hit the brakes, and things like that. But she loved that car. Not as much as she loved Mike and John, but she really liked it. She was well known around Canterbury Court for a number of things. I guess the most significant one was we have a talented artist there, and she had an art show downstairs in our community room. And I was there, and she walked up to this one picture, and she just went off on that picture, saying how terrible it was, no meaning to it, and the artist was standing right there. And I got so embarrassed that, boy, but if you all know Louise, that wasn't anything new for her. I really admired her for her ability to endure pain, as all you know, towards the last of her life. It really was almost unbearable. It would have been for most people. But I would stop by after playing golf out at Esmeralda Golf Course and visit. And boy, I just, you know, agonized for her and her tenacity and her ability to hang on. So that's my story about our friend Louise.
Until she broke her hip, and my mother was in Riverview Retirement Home in the assisted living portion, and she ended up going to the 24-hour care there. So I work with Mike, and Mike told me that his mom was at Riverview where my mom was, down in the care center, and she wouldn't be there much longer. She was towards the end, they were gonna let her go home. So I decided I would walk up the hall after visiting mom and go meet Mike's mom. Oh my God, she was just a pistol. She was just a fireball of energy. She said to me, oh, I'm so happy to meet you. You work with Mike. Well, I'm kind of busy right now, so why don't you come with me, because I've got a group getting together down in the community room. And she grabbed some books and a puzzle, and she said, first we're gonna do puzzles, and then, and on the way down, where I had a hard time keeping up with her, she would poke her head into every room and say, now, Martha, don't forget, we're meeting down here, and John, come on down now, don't just sit in the room here. She was gathering all those people together, and she really just had such a strong life force in her, and that was such a message to me, I guess, through all the things I knew about her, because I tend to always try and do the right thing, and say the right thing, and be the good girl, and Louise didn't worry about that so much. And you know what? Those are the people that you remember, the people that are just true to who they are and really live their life. And Louise had a shining light in her. And there was one time at Riverview where I was in a room where she was just bragging about Mike. Oh, my son, Mike, he does this for me and he does this for me. Which, by the way, was true. He made me feel terrible about how much I did for my mom, because he was always there. But she was just going on and on about the most wonderful son in the world. And then he came to pick her up, to take her to dinner, and she just went off on him about, you don't pick a lady up in a dirty car like this. You should have stopped and vacuumed your car. And shortly before she left for review, she was kind of moved around from table to table. I don't know if any of you are in the lunchroom. I don't know if you're familiar with how things go kind of in those retirement homes, but I'm always surprised in the lunch, the rooms where they go to eat, nobody says anything. They're so quiet while they eat, but not Louise. And so she would always end up insulting someone at the table and then have to be moved to a new table. So I came home one time and mom said, well, Louise is at our table now. I said, well, that's gonna be fun. The next night when I saw her, she said, do you know what she had the nerve to say to me? She said, honey, you need to get your daughter to come in and do something with your hair, or you just need to get a wig. Anyway, I so admired her spirit. And she did so love Mike. I can't tell you the number of times. I didn't know John. This is the first time I've met John, so I don't mean to exclude you. But since she knew I worked with Mike, she went so on about how great Mike was for a son. And I hope you take great comfort in that now, knowing how much you were there for her. So there was one more thing. I'm sure I'll remember it driving home.
I can give you a moment. Another story that came out of the eating area before we moved her out was whenever somebody new came to Riverview, they always put them with her because nobody else wanted to eat with her. And so it was like, this is the trial by fire, right? So this new fellow there, and the nurses told me this, it happened just that day. So this gentleman was sitting there, and she's talking to him, and he's continually saying, what? What? and he's reaching around, groping, and she's starting over, she's starting again, and what, what? And she said, what are you doing? He says, I'm looking for my hearing aid. And she said, well, when you find it, shove it up your ass.
She lost another hearing.
She was such a hoot to be around. You never knew what was coming out, but it was just
And I think that's true. I one of the things I really believe is that the truth, gently spoken, which wasn't necessarily Louise's forte, but gently spoken is always better than the most well-intentioned lie. I believe in truth. And so if Louise told you that you had a gift for astrology, by God, you did, because she would not say it if she did not believe it. And I like that about her so much. So anyway, that's all I had to share.
I have something I'd like to add. I met Louise in the early 1980s. It was here at Unity. And I found out that she was an astrologer. And I had been introduced to astrology many years before. And I thought, well, I'll go and have my chart done by her. She was totally amazing. She did my chart every year. And in the meantime, we became friends. And I went to many of her wonderful parties, ate many of her cinnamon rolls, and her fabulous pea soup. Do you remember the pea soup?
Yeah.
Oh, that was so good. I learned how to make good pea soup because of Louise. But anyway, I'll never forget that the day I was sitting by her side when she was consulting me about my life and my chart. And I was asking her so many questions, and she said, now, dear, I told you that this is perfect. And if you want to ask me so many questions, I want you to go get some astrology books and learn to be an astrologer. So actually, I did. And I do know quite a bit about astrology now because of Louise. But I turned into a numerologist instead. But it's about the same. But I just want to share one fun story. And Serena was there, and it was Thanksgiving. I'm sure you were there too, Josh. Serena and I were helping Louise in the kitchen. And Louise put the large baking dish that the turkey had been in the sink. Do you remember this? And so I went to the sink, not thinking, because I mean it was in the sink, right? And I turned the water on to rinse it out. And she says, what are you doing? What are you doing? That's our gravy drippings. And I said, oh, Louise, I didn't know. I thought you wanted it washed out. She says, well, you're going to have to figure out how we're going to have Thanksgiving gravy. And I looked at Serena and I said, we better go to Super One real fast and get a lot of packages of gravy mix. So Louise really was a wonderful person.
That is so funny. She has told me that story about the Thanksgiving dinner.
That was me. But we did have a lot of fun, and she loved to watch television and dramas and comedies. And when she had people that were living in her home, she was always so thoughtful because she would listen to everything with these extended earplugs. And I can remember walking in one day, and she says, "Oh, do you want to stay for dinner and have some pea soup?" And so I did. But she loved her dramas, and when there was a comedy, she would laugh hysterically. I'll never forget her laugh.
One of the things that drew me to Louise was there's a scripture in the Bible that says that I may know him in the power of his resurrection, and I know that she knows that now. But along with that verse, there's a it says that I may know the fellowship of his sufferings. And toward the end, many of you made mention of her suffering. And I know that she had fellowship with Christ in her times of suffering. And when I would go by to pray for her and spend some time with her, it was such a blessing to know that she had fellowship in the midst of suffering because Christ was there with her. And I love that about Louise, that she had a heart for truth, as many of you have said, and I know she found it in Jesus, and I was just really glad to be a part of that in the last several years of her life anyway. But she did speak highly of you guys all the time and appreciated her love for her sons, for sure. Very loving woman, but anyway, great gal.
I remembered my last name. I had the benefit of receiving one of Louisa's famous thank you notes. It was 3 pages. Very eloquently written. And that just reminded me, listening to both of her sons today, that's something she gave to both of you. You did such a nice job with what you said, both of you. I'm sure you got that from your mom.
What else?
Let me say a couple of words.
Okay.
Stay seated.
Sure. Whatever.
She encouraged me to go to Toastmasters a couple of times and never quite made it. I did take a speech class. My name's Robert Antle. I had the privilege of renting a basement apartment from Louise for probably 3 years, just over 3 years. And I, it's good to see you, Serena and Josh. Michael, thanks for inviting me. I see you driving into that driveway all the time. Every time I go by, you're pulling into the driveway. I was kind of in a rough spot in my life and looking for a place to live, and Louise was putting up a for rent sign. And I stopped and rolled down my window. She said, "Well, I knew the universe was going to send you." And, there wasn't any other application. And, I looked at the apartment. That'll work, and it's reasonable. And so many good memories. I was a tenant, but feel like family. The cinnamon rolls would show up at my door. There'd be a tap on the door. I made cinnamon rolls. One Christmas, she gave me a card with a dollar in it, and told me that that was seed money and plant and consciousness and water. It's been reaping rewards ever since. She was accepting of my coming and going, being a bachelor, and I got one garage spot in her two-car garage, which I managed to get two cars. The one I was working on, and one sat in the driveway, and she had another tenant upstairs who I'd usually have to kind of stay off the lawn a little bit. But neat lady. Anyway, he let me paint those garage doors and on her front porch, and told me I had talent for painting. And I was taking care of a grade school up the street and complaining about salary, like we all do. And she told me I should throw out my thoughts to the universe every day when I left for work, and it would happen. And lo and behold, within 5 months, I doubled my salary, and I joked, because it took me to Alaska, and I told her next time I want to be more specific and stay within less than 2,500 miles away. In that time, though, she was the most fantastic landlady, surrogate mom. She's let me sublet my apartment, and so I would have a place when I came back, and boxed up all my little junk and shoved it under a stairway. And she was so fair. She was just amazingly got in on a few of those dinners, you know, rake up all the chestnut leaves and pick up the yard, and I'd have a Thanksgiving dinner, you know, as payment. That was more than money. Anyway, thanks for inviting me.
I have to add, John, the same year you introduced your bride-to-be to Louise, he introduced his bride-to-be, me. I got in on a dinner, which was absolutely marvelous, and he was also told he'd be nice to her. And that was 18 years ago.
I really appreciate everything that all of you have the stories you've told about Louise. When I got to know Louise was later, when things weren't going so well for her. She was brought to my adult family home. And I better understand now why periodically the girls were telling me she really insulted another kid that wasn't there. But I think, and I also understand better now why when she broke her arm, I had such a devil of a time keeping the arm in the sling. Mm. So I really understand her better now. Because, you know, she wasn't as vibrant at the time when she came to live with us, but she was a doll, and she was so affectionate. You know, she loved to be her hugs and her kisses, and of course her sons, you know, and going out for ice cream. I mean, she could finish ice cream at dinner and Mike would come and then they'd go for ice cream. And there's no change in that. But I was very honored to be able to take care of her later when she needed care. And just to now to know more about Louise before she came. So I'm thanking all of you for what you shared about her.
If I can just say one small little thing about Louise, whatever she gathered together throughout her life, you know, what she left behind, you know, sons or three sons. The one son I know, Mike, has loved more than any child I could ever imagine, myself included. And it's just been so beautiful to see the devotion of a child to a mother who really isn't a mother anymore, you know, and it's just been the most glorifying thing in a sense to see where all of this has culminated, you know, because for years, you know, the suffering and everything, but, you know, like everybody said, you know, she found that peace. And I think the most precious thing that she said just before she left, and I don't know if you guys want to share that, but it just made the whole everything just light, you know? And I don't know, I don't want to offend you too, if I can just say what was passed on to me, you know, last things. She saw, and it wasn't even a words, there were words, and it mean nothing, but she saw something that she was going to, and her body, and her soul, and every piece of it, who she was,
cinnamon roll frosting and everything. Just left to go with what she said, you know, was understood as mama and papa. But that, for her sons, for her two sons to be there and to feel that through everything, is just the most beautiful, unbelievable gift. And I'm just really grateful that I'm a part of it. Thank you so much, Mike. And John.
I'd like to say something, add something. And I wanted to get this in my letter, but I didn't want to sound disrespectful or flippant. I remember taking Mom to the hospital, being with her in the hospital so many times, and they weren't always the greatest situation, but she would always say something that would she'd sometimes mistake men with long hair for women, or tattoos or piercings. They'd always get a comment, and she never did it out of meanness, but I'll always remember being with her and what she would say to people, and how memorable it was, and she really loved people. Mm-hmm. And to the last years, it was just whatever was in her mind would just come out. But she really loved people, and it's really wonderful to know how many people she impacted, because I know that I was lucky that she was my mother. And then I'm so thankful for the last 10 years of being with her and holding her hand. And anyway, I just want to get that out. She was a character. She took her to the ball. One time, I took her for, she wanted a new pair of shoes, and we went to the shoe store by Northtown, and she had a pair that was only 3 months old, but she wants a new pair of shoes, so we'll take her up there. And then the girl helping us must have taken 30 pairs out and showed them to Mom, and fit them all, and the only one that Mom liked was the exact same pair that she had worn in there. I'm very lucky that I had her for a mother. I was so lucky, and that she'll always live in my heart.
I just want to say something to both John and Mike and Raymond, who isn't here. And I think I speak for everybody who's a mother here in this room, is to be blessed as a mother to have sons that are so kind, so devoted, so loving, even in the hard times and the times when things are just have diminished, is a blessing that we can all only hope and pray for. And you all three of you, and you two especially, and Michael, you were truly a trooper. Need to really take comfort in knowing that you are the best sons that you possibly could be.
Are we complete? What a rich sharing. And as I mentioned before, go out and live this now. You talked about all the qualities that you were inspired by and saw in her. So be that person. Be Louise in your daily life and let her spirit continue its journey through you. We do have a reception planned in Fellowship Hall, cake and cookies for you. At the end, we'll conclude with a short prayer, and then I think we're going to sing the peace song, aren't we, John? Okay, and those of you who know that, we invite you to join hands. So let's close with prayer. She has taken on invisibility, dear Lord. I cannot see. Yet this I know. Although the road ascends and passes from her sight, there will be no night. You have taken her gently by the hand and lead her on along the road of life that never ends. And she will know not death, but dawn. I do not doubt that you are there as here, and that you hold her dear. Our life did not begin with birth. It is not of this earth. And this that we call death is no more than the opening and closing of a door. And in your house, how many rooms must be beyond this one, where we rest momently? Dear Lord, we thank you for the faith that frees and for the love that knows it cannot lose its own. A love that, looking through the shadows, sees that you and she and I are ever one. And so now, Louise, we loose you and we let you go. But we do so in this faith, that the light of God surrounds you, the love of God enfolds you, the power of God protects you, and the presence of God watches over you. Wherever you are, God is, and all is well. Amen. I invite you to stand and join hands as we sing together, "Let There Be Peace." In fact, we could form a circle around the outside if you like. You want to lead us, Julie? Thank you.
Cake's on.
Cake's on.